Yes, we're going to start. Good morning, everyone. My name is Guy Weyns. I'm a manager in Morgan Stanley's Investment Research Division in New York, and I have the pleasure to chair this session in which we look at selected academic work in accounting for risk and uncertainty. It's a subject that's very close to my heart, at least at Morgan Stanley, where my friend and mentor, Trevor Harris, and I rolled out a framework globally that really tries to force equity research analysts to get away from false precision and explicitly and consistently look at upside and downside scenarios in their work, which I think is going to be connected somewhat to the work that Anette Mikes is going to present when she talks about risk envisionment. So it's a subject close to my heart. I think it's a subject close to Trevor's heart. We have an excellent lineup of work in this session, so I'm going to keep this very brief. But what I try to do in the following slides, and following four slides, is to take the perspective of a non-expert and going through all the research that is going to be presented here and just get a very high-level takeaway from it. And that will lead necessarily to oversimplification, for which I apologize, but I know that my panel is going to enthusiastically correct that oversimplification as soon as they get the chance. This is, of course, squarely in the field of accounting research. Because all the faculty members, basically accounting faculty members, and that didn't necessarily come out of the first session here, but these guys are all accounting faculty and going to talk, in some cases, directly about the relationship between accounting or accounting data and risk assessment or uncertainty assessment. In other cases, a little bit more indirectly, but I just wanted to position the group here. We'll start with Doron Nissim, who is going to talk to us about how the market prices insurers equity risk, and the literature is going to be familiar to a whole bunch of you, but equity risk, essentially measured by the implied cost of equity capital and the implied equity risk premium. That implied equity risk premium is going to be related to some macro and firm-specific factors. Then there's going to be an exercise to relate that ex ante implied risk premium to subsequent stock returns. And I think, separately, and forgive me, Doron, if I say separately, because you probably have a way to connect it, he's going to talk about the reporting analysis and valuation aspects of accumulated other comprehensive income, if there is still time for that. Then we move on to, and there's a logic in this for which I have to thank my dear colleague Don Chu for helping me sort of, weave a thread in this. There is Mark Bradshaw, who's going to talk to us about opacity, crash risk, and option smear curves. The logic being that it's also about how the market prices risk, and in this case, risks of extreme negative stock price movements, which he calls crash risk. He's going to relate that to the lack of transparency or lack of transparency, opacity of financial statements, and he's going to work with the options smile curve, I still called it, shows you how things have evolved, to the smirk curve, to see whether the market prices that risk correctly, given the information that's available in the public domain, especially accounting-based information. Then, staying with the topic this time of accounting transparency or opacity, and even staying with the market pricing of risk, but this time financing risk, is Rodrigo Verdi from MIT, who is going to talk about whether firms with higher financial reporting quality actually suffer less, and that'll be obviously appropriately defined what that means, but suffer less in tough times with respect to their capacity to finance investment projects. So he's going to look at real estate as a way of operationalizing that as an important source of collateral for financing. If that collateral gets shocked or dented, what is the relationship between sensitivity of investments to shock to collateral value on the one hand and financial reporting quality on the other hand? Simply put, do firms with higher quality suffer less when their collateral is being shocked and their capacity to finance is reduced? And then, very interestingly, do firms actually make improvements to FRQ in response to negative shocks and collateral value? And I'll be very interested to see how that gets operationalized. Then finally, and so part of logic was market pricing of risk. The other part of the taxonomy of what's going on here is firm level versus user level. We sort of switched to the firm level with Rodrigo, looking at how firms' capacity to make investments in tough times is impacted. We finally have a presentation from Anette Mikes from HBS, which really fascinates me, and talks about her insights from field work on corporate risk management practice. Talks about counting risk and about making risk count. What's very interesting there to me was the presence of alternative calculative cultures, because the practice of risk envisionment versus relentless risk measurement is something that's very close to our hearts at Morgan Stanley when it comes to the equity research analysts. We don't think that you can be all quant, and use past historical information, even implied option information, to be really insightful about risk in a forward-looking way. But the bit that's maybe slightly outside of the common thread here, but fascinates me tremendously, is her work on boundary work, and how these calculative cultures actually lead to different prominence or influence of the risk function within an organization. And of course, Anette will talk a lot more about that. But that's the bird's eye view. And again, from a non-expert, please, all of you, correct me immediately. And without further ado, I'd like to give it over to Doron now.
Thank you. Okay, good morning. So my presentation is about providing a few insights regarding risk and financial reporting in the insurance industry. And if there is one industry where risk is at the core, it's obviously the insurance industry. And, at one level, it's the product itself. Most other industries, you have the sale, and then soon after the sale, we pretty much have a reasonable certainty regarding the profit from the transaction. The insurance industry is an industry where we have a lot of uncertainty remaining, possibly for many years with some lines, regarding what the ultimate profit will be. So risk and uncertainty are at the product level, just, by the nature of the product. But also, more fundamentally, this industry is really about risk. It's about spreading risk. And the idea is basically the law of large numbers. If you take a portfolio of policies, then the total risk of the portfolio is less than the sum of the individual risks. So it's basically diversification. And this is where the primary value creation in this industry. Well, we also have it on the asset side, because insurance get the premium, and then they invest the premium. And they invest in relatively large portfolios. So again, we have the benefit of diversification from the asset side, reducing idiosyncratic risk that we have in investment. So the insurance industry is about basically managing, reducing risk through diversification. But obviously, in the end, we still have some risk retained. And risks are retained because we have systematic risks. If you talk about property casualty, then it's catastrophe risk is the primary systematic risk. Talk about life and health, it's longevity and mortality risk. And especially for life and health insurance companies, significant market risks too. And also there is limits to diversification. So while in insurance we basically create value through diversification, there are various reasons why we know that this is not going to completely reduce or eliminate the risk, even the idiosyncratic portion of the risk. So we are still left with some risk from the operations and from the investments. Now, on top of it, you can put some risk mitigation programs. So you can reinsure some of the risk, or you can use capital market solutions that are increasingly available. More traditionally, asset liability management. Obviously, capital is a cushion against the losses, and so on. So we can mitigate risks through these different mechanisms. But at the end, we still have some risk left. And this risk is or should be borne by equity holders. So my question, the first study that I'm going to discuss with you, results from the first study I'm going to discuss is basically looking at the pricing of this equity risk. And I'm basically going to look at the time series and cross-sectional determinants of this, the pricing of this equity risk. I'm going to look at differences in the pricing of equity risk across the sub-industries within the insurance industry. And I'm going to specifically provide, I believe, some interesting insights regarding the financial crisis. The way that I measure risk here is through the implied cost of equity capital, or more specifically, implied equity risk premium. The implied cost of equity capital is basically internal rate of return. Internal rate of return that you calculate from price and analyst forecast. And in this study, this version of the study, I actually use individual analysts. So the day that an individual analyst issues a set of forecast regarding an insurance company, the day that these forecasts are available, I take the price that day, and I derive the implied internal rate of return, subtract from it the 10-year treasury yield, and I have a proxy for the risk premium for that company based on the observed price, and at that point, the observed forecast by the analyst. And we know that we care a lot about the implied cost of equity capital, implied equity risk premium. Peter has basically focused his research on this for the last few years. And we care about this for various reasons. And my argument is part of the motivation for looking at the insurance industry in this context. Obviously, again, I provided the motivation earlier on why risk is critical in this industry. But really, the insurance industry is also an opportunity, a setting that allows for relatively precise measurement of implied cost of equity capital. So this is the first set of results. What you have here, basically what we have here, is, so I calculate from the early 80s through 2011. Every time that an analyst issues enough forecast to be able to calculate an internal rate of return, I calculate that internal rate of return. And to be able to plot this over time, what I did was basically to take a consecutive 100 observations, consecutive in times, and the median implied cost of equity capital, median implied cost of equity capital. This is the treasury yield, the 10-year treasury yield, and this is the implied equity risk premium, which is basically just the difference between these two figures. The internal cost of equity capital and the risk-free rate, the 10-year treasury yield. And what we see is that throughout this sample period, for about 20 years or so, from the mid-80s until the financial crisis, the implied equity risk premium, the median, over 100 consecutive observations, was always between 5 and 8%, and quite stable. But in the early 80s, it was at a lower level. And let's see what happened in the financial crisis. It jumped to the sky. So the initial version of this paper, I used the consensus forecast. And there the issue was the potential delay. So I thought that maybe part of the high risk premium is simply a reflection of the fact that analysts didn't have an opportunity to update the forecast. But in this version of the paper, it's actually same day price, the day that the analyst issued the forecast. So basically what it says is that during this period, during the height of the financial crisis, analysts issued forecasts that many times implied a 20% or close to 20% equity risk premium. And so I think I found this result quite shocking. I obviously didn't expect it to be that high. And there are several other interesting things that we can see from this trend. First, there is a strong negative correlation between the treasury yield and the implied equity risk premium. So overall, the implied cost of equity capital is more stable than the premium, or at least the extreme values of the premiums, when we have extreme values for the premiums, very low, they are less extreme when it comes to the implied cost of equity capital because of this negative correlation between the premium and interest rates. So the next thing that I did was to actually look at the sub-industries within the insurance industry. And we have five sub-industries if you follow the GIC classification. But life and health and property and casualty account for each one of them for more than one-third of the observations. So I'm basically going to look at three groups: life and health, property and casualty, and the other three groups. And coming into this, the expectation is that for life and health and property and casualty, we have very different risk profile. So it's a financial profile and also the operations. There are good reasons to expect that the equity, that the pricing of equity risk will be quite different for the two industries. And, you know, if you think about the fact that life and health insurance companies have much more leverage, they're similar to banks than they are, more similar to banks than to property and casualty. If you think about the fact that the investments of property casualty companies tend to be much more liquid, generally less risky. Then if you think about operations with property and casualty, we have much more a frequency and magnitude of claims, much more volatility there. And when you think about life and health insurance, there we have the exposure to market risk, which are increasingly important. If it comes from the spread business, the fact that you're basically making money from the difference between what you make on the investments and the cost of the liabilities, the fact that many life and health insurance companies manage, generate much of their income so from managing accounts, basically, asset under management or separate accounts, variable annuities, and so on. And as we saw during the financial crisis, we also have a lot of exposure to market risk that comes from these guarantees that they provide on many of the products, primarily variable annuities, but other products too. So we would expect a very different pricing of equity risk, but skip this one. But if you do the same exercise for the implied equity risk premium for each of these sub-industries, you'd actually don't see this. Throughout the period, from the early 80s until the financial crisis, the median, here I'm using 50 consecutive observations because it's sub-samples, what you see is that the equity risk premium was actually very similar for each of the three sub-industries. This was the case until the financial crisis. In financial crisis, for life and health, it jumped to the sky. And for the other omitted three subcategories, it also increased a lot. It increased less for the property and casualty. And for property and casualty, it basically came back by the end of the sample period, which is January 2011. It came back to the level that we had, say, in 2005. For life and health and the other three omitted categories here, it remained higher, significantly higher. So what I did next was to actually look at more systematically at the time series and the firm-specific characteristics of insurance companies that affect their implied cost of equity capital. And the results are generally, you know, so I have here several macro factors, and I have here several firm-specific characteristics that come from all the research that we have about insurance companies, what would be relevant there, as well as the more traditional risk proxies like market beta, volatility, and so on. And the results are, I think some of the associations are very strong from the time series and from the cross section. So specifically, I find that these are the variables that appear to matter most. Very strong correlation, negative correlation with the 10-year treasury yield. So when the 10-year treasury yield is high, we saw that in the figure earlier on, the implied equity risk premium is low. Very strong correlation with the credit spread. The initial version of this paper, I included the VIX, which was extremely significant. In this version, it's no longer significant. And the reason it's no longer significant is simply because I included the credit spread in this version. If I omit the credit spread, this becomes increasingly significant. It becomes very significant. So basically, the credit spread appeared to capture much of what is being valued at the equity level. This is the market credit spread, the difference in the yield on Moody's BAA and AAA. This appears to be the most important factor in terms of time series variation in the implied equity risk premium for insurance companies. And again, in terms of one result, which I think is also quite unique to the insurance industry, is the importance of volatility, idiosyncratic volatility, probably for the same reason that I discussed earlier on, that there is some idiosyncratic volatility that is still being retained by insurance companies for the reasons that I mentioned earlier on. Okay, so some interesting result here. Another very important determinant is the equity to asset ratios, and again, there are good reasons for why this is the case. So, I repeated the same analysis by industry, and the results are stronger. They're generally quite consistent across industries, but they are stronger for life and health insurance companies. So then I say, okay, so we have this implied equity risk premium. or implied cost of equity capital, does it really predict stock returns going forward? And the answer is it does, but primarily for life and health insurance companies. So after you control for everything that you can control, here I'm basically eliminating all the macro variation because I'm including a dummy for each day. So what you find, you do find different versions show you predictability. So it's excess stock return is the dependent variable, and the implied equity risk premium is the independent variable, and again, with some controls in the last panel. And you find the predictability, and it's especially strong for life and health insurance companies. So this is the some results from the first study. I have another 5 minutes. Okay. So another study, that these are both working papers that I'm currently working on. This study looks at relative valuation, multiple-based method, as well as other relative valuation methods, which includes additional stuff besides multiples. Two of the results in this study that are relevant in this context, and the link is not very strong, but it is relevant to risk in the insurance industry. I'm going to focus actually mostly on this one, which is really unique to the insurance industry. So it's quite common to see the following. So when you read analyst report, analysts following insurance companies, primarily life and health, but also other insurers, see many times the numbers that they focus on when it comes to book value is book value excluding accumulated other comprehensive income. Why do analysts exclude this? There is a good reason for it. There are several reasons, but the primary one that accumulated other comprehensive income is being excluded when calculating return on equity or price to book multiples, the primary reason is coming from the following fact. And I'm going to go through the financial statements of insurance companies to explain this issue. So what you have here are 10 years of data, 11 years of data for the insurance industry in the US, basically all insurance companies with data available in CompuStat. So here we have all this column. So this one is for all insurance companies. This one is for life and health, property and casualty, and the other three categories. And so this is the common size balance sheet, the asset side of the common size balance sheet. And the point I want to make here is investments are obviously very significant. They are actually even more significant than what is implied here, because once you include separate account assets, which are really just asset under management, very similar to asset under management, see that 71% of the asset is basically investment assets. And when you look deeper into what we have in investments, it's primarily investment in securities, And when you look within the investment in securities, it's primarily fixed income securities. Why is this relevant? It's relevant because we know that insurance companies classify most of these investments as available for sale. And with available for sale securities, we mark to market. Every period when we prepare the financial statements, we adjust the investment account, which again is primarily fixed income securities. We don't report the unrealized gain or loss in income. Generally, we don't report. Instead, we put it into accumulated other comprehensive income. So for example, if interest rates go up, the investments go down in value, and book value will go down because we will reduce accumulated other comprehensive income. That's the accounting treatment. And if we switch now to the liability side of the balance sheet, and again, after excluding separate account liabilities, we see that most of the liabilities and equity here, 60% of the balance sheet, liabilities and equity, even more so for life and health. How do we account for these liabilities? Extremely complicated. I spent a lot of time really learning how this accounting works. Now that I think I have a reasonable understanding of it, we know that these things, so we have different types of reserves within insurance liabilities reserves, but what is common to essentially all of them is that it's historical cost accounting. We're generally using the historical amounts, the historical interest rates. So going back to the story, let's say interest rates go down, the interest rates go up, the investment go down in value, but we don't mark the reserve. So we basically create artificial volatility in book value. Mark to market the investment, you don't mark to market the reserve liabilities, which means that accumulated other comprehensive income introduces artificial volatility into book value. This is an argument, it's a good argument, and for this reason, many times analysts, and again, I went through many analyst reports, and many of you know this better than me, many analysts following this industry exclude accumulated other comprehensive income from book value, and I just showed you an example. Should they? Should they do so? So what I do here is I basically use multiple valuation with total book value and excluding accumulated other comprehensive income, and I compare. So I'm basically assuming here that the stock price is an efficient indication of intrinsic value. Strong assumption. But under this assumption, the data suggests that we should not exclude accumulated other comprehensive income. We clearly get more, and what you think about this axis, the Y here is measuring how precise the valuation is. The blue line here being used book value. When you exclude accumulated other comprehensive income, consistently throughout the 10 years that we have data, you get valuations which do not replicate price as good as total book value does. So this result suggests you should not exclude accumulated other comprehensive income, which is a very common practice in the insurance industry. I'm trying to think what is going on here. Well, many times when we exclude special items, or in this case it's unrealized gains or losses, the logic that we have is, when we exclude it from income, is that we want a measure of permanent income. And we want something that cannot be, that is not affected by manipulation. So for example, we are worried that a company is selling a security with unrealized gain, it will cause net income to go up. This makes income discretionary and less informative. But you see, with book value, it's exactly the opposite. It's when you sell security that book value, excluding accumulated other comprehensive income, is changing. So I think this is what is going on here. It's the opposite effect. So the logic says get rid of a one-time item. But you know, if you think about the accounting, when you sell a security that has an unrealized gain, you're basically affecting X accumulated comprehensive income book value, but you don't change overall book value. I think this is the reason for this result. And I think I covered my 15 minutes.
Yeah, perfect. We will come back to all of this with the Q&A, I have no doubt. But if Mark could come up now. Sorry for the military schedule here. Thank you.
Okay, I have a decision to make at the beginning because a couple months ago I messed up two of the discs in my lower back. And at breakfast this morning, Phil Berger said that I might be able to talk about that for 10 or 15 minutes, staying within the topic of assessing tail risk. And Peter said he's a fan of broad perspectives, but I don't have slides, so I'll go with my original plan. So this is a new paper co-authored with three other faculty members at Boston College. And it's a nice collaboration because half of us are accounting faculty and the other half are finance. And so what we're going to look at is, you know, financial reporting stuff and option pricing. And so the finance half of the authors are learning more about financial reporting, and the two accountants are learning more about options. So, you know, this is a title that will surely change soon. It sounds very academic and nice, but it's not all that informative. You know, so what we're really talking about is accounting discretion, sort of the stockpiling of bad news by manipulating away negative shocks, really bad outcomes, big stock price drops. And trying to link that with sophisticated investor expectations, and these are the option pricing models that we're going to use. Okay, and so most people are like I was when I initially sort of got into this. I didn't know what a smart curve was. I think I'd heard of a small, but I didn't really know, so we might as well clear it up. A smart curve is a skewed smile. Does that clear it up? What it basically, there used to be a smile that's now turned to something like this, where if you graph out for any underlying, for the implied volatility across a whole chain of options, what you see is the implied volatility is really high for deep out-of-the-money option, put options in particular. And so that's not possible under the Black-Scholes option pricing assumptions. So either the model's wrong, or there is something that's picked up when you look at deep out of the money put prices that's capturing a climate of expectations where investors seem to be preparing or banking on a big stock price drop in terms of either profitability or potentially an insurance perspective. So this is what we're going to be looking at to get information about expectations of big stock price drops. So, you know, steeper the smirk curve, that left-hand side there, that's the empirical wrestling match we're going to have, is how do you measure that? And that's, you know, going to be linked to actual stock price drops, and then we're going to see if financial reporting measures can either supplement or compete with the option pricing information. Okay, so, you know, generally I'll tell you about the three stars of the show, then talk to you about how we calculate them or prepare them, and then show you the brief results. So despite working with, you know, something complex like option pricing, this is actually a very simple study. So the smirk curves, like I sort of just gave you a summary, these have been investigated by a small, concentrated set of finance faculty members, and largely in the context of looking at whether the smirk, the observed smirk curve, in other words, the expensiveness of out-of-the-money put options, gets steeper before big macro shocks. And so the original, you know, the big paper in this area is Bates, who looked at right before the 1987 market crash, did option prices, you know, for deep out-of-the-money puts tend to steepen beforehand. And it's quite elegant. And there have been a number of other studies that look, you know, at the Japanese crisis, and there certainly will be one on the recent crisis. But these are all done at the, you know, aggregate, like macro level, using an index. And so, you know, we're marrying two finance perspectives with two accounting perspectives. And as accountants, what we're primarily interested in and have comparative advantage is looking at firm-specific information. So examining, you know, a smirk curve at the firm level, much less of a trodden path. And so we're moving from an index sort of view of smirk curves to firm-specific, which is going to bring its own empirical problems, but we'll talk about those. Crash risk, you know, I think that's in the title. We're actually talking about just crash incidents. So we, you know, what's our proxy for crash risk? Actual crashes. But we're going to quantify big stock price movements as, you know, three standard deviation movements of a weekly return within a 12-month period. And so it turns out, I mean, these are large price changes, but under this definition, we end up having a whole lot more stock price crashes than you'd expect when you're using a three standard deviation benchmark. And then finally, our financial reporting construct is a word that I detest more than anything, but it's opacity. And I'll describe how we capture this. But the idea comes from a lot of these analytical papers that talk about managers having incentives. And this is not surprising to a lot of us familiar with the empirical research and financial reporting. Managers have incentive to avoid reporting small negative shocks as they occur. So they stockpile them somehow, and at some point in time, it's either not in the manager's best interest to keep stockpiling, it becomes too costly, and they release the information to the market, at which time all of the, you know, reaction to those hidden negative shocks comes to play. That's the idea that we're trying to piece together here. Okay, so there's, like I said, there's three things we look at, and they're all pretty standard. So the first thing we're going to do is just document in a firm-specific setting that opacity, or our measure of opacity, financial reporting, stockpiling of bad news, is indeed associated with subsequent big price declines. Okay, and this is not new. This is in the literature already. Then we're going to see if that same measure of financial reporting opacity is associated with steepness, you know, greater steepness in smirk curves, right? And what's that? That's going to tell us, you know, one of two things. One is, you know, they're either, you know, moderating or mediating variables. One, the most likely that we might expect is that the sophisticated traders that are pricing these options will understand the firm-specific information, and so we ought to see a positive association between opacity and, you know, the market's measure of stock price crashes. And then finally, and this is sort of the main point, it's just a horse race, right? We're going to see if indeed, you know, smirk curves, opacities is, we're going to show you, is associated with stock price drops. And then we're going to see if smirk curves, which are like, you know, have been shown in the aggregate level to forecast price decreases, if smirk curves predict crash risk, and the picture's not exactly right, you know, in the presence of financial reporting opacity. So it's basically a horse race, right? And, you know, inevitably we find that they're incrementally informative over one another. And so what does that mean as far as the takeaway? It tells you if you're interested in assessing firm-specific stock price crashes, you've got an easy metric, which is the option, the volatility skew, and you can supplement it by some simple financial statement analysis. Okay, so just as an aside, you know, we're going to focus on price drops, not price jumps on the positive side. And why not? Because it certainly would be nicer to predict price jumps on the positive side than shorts, right? It turns out, you know, there's a number of reasons to go with the price drops. Crashes are much more common in terms of frequency than price jumps. And based on toying around with the data, we kind of have a suspicion that the most big price jumps that would qualify like three standard deviations are acquisition announcements. So if you can predict that, then that's a nice way to go. And the story doesn't seem to be symmetric, right? In other words, you're overly forthcoming with news, and that somehow leads to greater incidence of stock price jumps. It doesn't really make sense. Okay, so back onto what we're doing. Crashes, we define it two ways. One's a 0-1 variable, crash, no crash. And the other is capturing the magnitude. So what we have to do is, we have to just make a decision. We're not using daily price changes. We're separating a year into 52 weeks and looking at the price change within the week. And so we look at basically across the firm's 12-month period, you got 52 observations. What's the standard deviation? And if a week shows a price drop to greater than three standard deviations of that series, it's classified as a crash. Okay? And the other is, and again, this is, I didn't say this, but the way we do is we take the returns, regress them on an expanded market model that includes, you know, the industry lead and lag returns, Fama French factors. And so the residuals are what qualifies as the return. It's not the absolute return. I missed to say that. And then to come up with a magnitude of the actual crash, we take the minimum return during the year and call that extreme return. Okay, so opacity, he put modified Jones model up on the slide. He's going to get attacked. So, but this is the idea is we're just using a basic measure, which everybody knows and doesn't seem to like, but the modified Jones model to capture just some measure of discretionary accruals. And what we're going to do is we're not interested in the signed aspect. We're taking the unsigned abnormal accruals across the lag 3 years. And so that's hoping to get at what I talked about a minute ago, the stockpiling of bad news. Well, and I'll show you in the timeline in a second, what it also picks up by taking the unsigned version is the typical pattern of manipulation or hiding of news is, you know, manipulate a year, manipulate another year up, and then the turnaround happens because of the tyranny of double entry accounting. So we pick up the build up, and the reversal. You know, if you want to pick up an aggregate, you're going to end up washing them out. So that's why we do this 3-year moving sum of absolute discretionary accruals. And so this is what I just mentioned. So that, you know, this is, from the restatement study that Dechow, Hutton, and Sloan did, the blue arrows are hopefully what we're picking up when we lag 3 years of absolute discretionary accruals. Assuming that the line near zero, which is non-manipulating firms in their sample, approximates what the firm would otherwise have. So as far as measuring the smirk curve, the key to understanding smirk curves, if you look at the red line here, this is graphing an options delta. And so deltas range between 0 and 1 for calls or negative 0 I'll just call it -0 and -1 for puts. And it just tells you how sensitive the price of the option is to a price of the underlying. So in other words, a deep in the money put option increases increases in value by a dollar for every dollar decrease in stock price. And so the delta for that for a deep into the money put is -1. And on the other side is a deep out of the money. So the question is, you know, if this is what the smirk kind of looks like, the implied volatility is really high for out of the money puts and, you know, lower or stable for in the money. You've got to pick some point on this option chain to figure out how to measure the steepness of this smirk curve. And so I don't know if it's say this is somewhat arbitrary, but what we do is we pick at the money put options, which is a delta of -0.5, right? So a price in the underlying changes it is likely to change it either way. And we use an out of the money put location of -0.2 deltas. What's that get you? It kind of filters out the noise from extreme out of the money puts, right? And so this the results aren't that sensitive. And then we just form a ratio of implied volatility at this point divided by the implied volatility for in the or at the money put options. So the steeper that smirk, the higher that value is going to be, okay? And then what we want to pick up is not crash risk driven by other macroeconomic factors that might affect the market as a whole. So then we take the S&P smirk calculation for the same deltas and just scale them to try to filter out the market, okay? And then as complete overkill, we average this metric over the 10 days at the prior year before we measure crashes. Okay, now this is important to understand. So the timeline is we've got 3 years where we measure opacity, the buildup and maybe reversal of discretionary accruals. We measure the smirk at the end of those three fiscal years. And then we go to the whole year following to capture the crashes. Now, I didn't say it, but the options we use, we have to fix it. That's my alarm telling me to stop. But we use 90-day options, so there's some slippage between 90-day options and looking at crashes within 360 days, right? So so we can do some work here, but this is important to notice this. Okay, so we get a couple thousand firms per year, so we're picking up, this is a big sample. This is just some descriptive data on the calculated smirk. So the smirk for the firm-specific smirks are not as steep as the smirks for the market, for the S&P 500 index. Kind of makes sense because those are used much more extensively by investors. And so our first question, yes indeed, we measure our opacity measure and crash probability actually climbs with financial reporting opacity. Good. Second is, is the put smirk associated with financial reporting opacity? I've highlighted it so you don't look at any of the other numbers, and you can see it's significantly positively associated with opacity. And then the horse race shows that they both come through strong in the presence of controlling for the other. So what this tells us is there's information in the financial statements that can supplement price information and prices around options that predicts, you know, a somewhat rare event like a stock price crash. And thank you.
Perfect. Thank you, Mark. Rodrigo?
Okay, morning, everybody. Before I start, just like to thank Peter and Trevor to invite me here to present. This is very early work. We just finished the first draft of this paper about like 30 days ago, so we're kind of eager to get some feedback, and if you have some comments, I'll be happy to talk to either after the session or later on as well. So this is joint work with Kartik Balakrishna, who's sitting there at the back, and then John Kaur, which is my colleague at MIT. So I was thinking of the presentation here and look at the agenda, and then the first thing I realized is that what we're doing here is slightly different than what we've been talking about so far. So I added this kind of very first slide here and say, well, what's the conference theme? No, the conference team seems to be on uncertainty and risk. So how does my paper relate to that, if anything, right? So the first thing is, as Guy Weyns was saying, that the two papers and the discussion before is about people, investors predicting risk and dealing with risk and trying to mitigate and measure risk. We take a slightly different approach here because you look at the firm and look at reporting quality, so it's almost that we take risk as given. Risk it is, and uncertain it is what it is, and in facing risk, how does financial reporting quality potentially matter? So basically what we do here, it's we try to look at some sort of exogenous shock to the value of real estate assets that firms have. And I'll talk about this in more detail in a few slides, but just trying to give like the three bullet point overview here. So you have a shock to the value of the real estate assets. Presumably, that increases uncertainty to capital providers, increases the risk to people giving money to the firm, and affects the external financing capacity and the ability for that firm to invest. Given that, we try to look at the role of reporting quality. How is it that reporting quality can play a role and try to mitigate that shock with respect to investment in here? They actually kind of like closest paper to this, what we are doing here, Christian Lloyds and Kathy Schwinn, they have a similar paper trying to look at a shock, but they look at a shock to cost of capital. To some extent, our shock has cost of capital effects, but we're building from the literature that looks more on the investment side and try to look at the investment implications out of it. So again, a little bit of repetition here, but just to kind of stress the point. So specifically, how is it that we measure this shock, and what are the research questions in the paper? So shock here is state level variations in price. So you can think of a firm that has some real estate assets mainly located in a certain, like in Connecticut, and then all of a sudden the price in Connecticut, not in the US and not for that firm, but price in Connecticut go up or down for whatever reasons, and that affects the value of the collateral that that firm has and the ability to finance. Once we look at there, then we look at the consequence of this shock. One is, do firms with higher reporting quality kind of quote unquote suffer less? And by what I mean suffer less here is that do they actually suffer less in their ability to reduce investment capacity? So prior finance research show well, once you have this shock, you cannot finance anymore, and mainly you, as much at least, and you cannot invest as much. And then you try to see whether firms with higher reporting quality can kind of overcome that and potentially continue to invest. But I also try to kind of endogenize disclosure here and go to the voluntary disclosure literature and say, well, given that you have this shock, this changes your equilibrium kind of level of disclosure and might provide incentives for firms to change and start kind of disclosing more or less given the new scenario that they're facing, this shock to the financing capacity. So you can think of the first research question here in which reporting quality is quote unquote exogenous and serving as a kind of like mitigating mechanism. And then we kind of turn this to a more realistic scenario in which disclosures are choice by firms and they can kind of firms respond and try to react to this shock. And those are the two big things you're going to try to investigate here. The hypothesis, it builds pretty much from the kind of investment literature, so it comes on three pieces. First one is the classic kind of Myers and Majlow story that information asymmetry matters for investment, for financing, in the sense that when you have information asymmetry between the firm and the capital providers, Lemon's problem, you know, capital providers discount the price and they kind of like want to raise the cost of raising the equity, affects the firm's ability to finance. Then there is another stream of research in finance that says, well, given the information asymmetry problem, if you have collateralizable assets, that might serve as a way to mitigate the information asymmetry. So there must be a lot of information asymmetry, but as long as I can take your assets as collateral, I'm willing to bear the risk, and if anything goes wrong, I have the asset. So it mitigates that information problem. Remember that my proxy for the shock is what happens if collateral is not available. Then what we try to do is coming from the accounting side and say, well, perhaps financial reporting can serve that role as well, in the sense that there's lots of disclosure papers here showing that financial reporting quality mitigates information asymmetry problems, mitigates adverse selection problems. So the question is, in the absence of collateral, would information asymmetry serve a kind of substitute effect and provide firms to continue financing in here? So I'm going to kind of put a three-period example here just to kind of like think about the timeline of what we are doing here. So think of the period before a shock. Then you have the shock to financing capacity. And shock in here meaning like, say, your real estate assets can reduce by 5%. And then you have the period after the shock. So before the shock, firms will have some level of reporting quality. whatever that is. It's equilibrium reporting quality, a function of many factors like contracting, compensation, valuation, financing, litigation, many things that drive reporting quality. And I'm kind of being vague here and intentionally quoting these exogenous, even though we know that that's kind of not quite true. Then, given the shock, what happens is that the firms lose, and let's, just to make it clear, let the shock be a negative shock. So collaterals went down. You could tell the same story with collaterals went in, going up, but let's say it went down. So the firms have lower ability to finance now, and they're gonna start passing up projects that would be positive NPV if they could raise that capital at that cost, but they can't. So to the extent that reporting quality substitute in mitigating this information problem, this adverse selection problem, that is the kind of the one main hypothesis here. Well, then, once you see that shock, the firms with higher reporting quality to quote-unquote suffer less. They will cut investment less so than what you observe for firms with kind of poor reporting. But then we try to think of a kind of like alternative scenario, potentially more realistic, which is, well, here reporting quality is exogenous, and this is largely what people have done in literature in investment, including myself, so we kind of assume that it's exogenous, but chances are the firms practice reporting quality are endogenous, and firms can kind of then change their disclosure and start kind of voluntarily disclosing more if they have now higher incentives to disclose. So we try to look at firms respond to this negative shock by increasing their level of disclosure. And then the prediction here is that given a negative shock or a decrease in finance capacity, we should start observing more voluntary disclosure choices, increasing kind of like disclosure activity. So that's the two hypotheses you're gonna see some results right now. So this is basically the formal hypothesis here that in one case, reporting quality is a conditioning variable mitigating this shock to investment relation. In the second one, reporting quality is the dependent variable as some sort of a response to this shock. So let me be a little bit specific what I mean by this shock and how we go about measuring it. So the main idea here comes from this finance paper that say, if collateral values go down, this affects the ability to finance and ability to invest. So we're gonna try to build on this idea, but to deal with some endogeneity issues here, we try to look at state level variations in the prices or real estate prices as this proxy for the change in the firm value, the value of the firm real estate assets. So use state level because presumably it's less kind of like reflecting the firm, but it's reflecting some sort of exogenous movement in real estate prices. And you're using real estate because this is a big source of collateral. So this is like one of the assets that firms will often use to collateralize and raise more capital. And then also based on this prior research that kind of collateral assets affect the financing capacity. So let me give a specific example here. Let's take IBM and just show you kind of how I go about measuring it. So we go to the financial statements of IBM. When we stop in 1993, just because so happens that until 1993, we can get the kind of like accumulated depreciation cost in of pieces of the real estate. So I don't want to kind of use, not real estate, kind of fixed assets. So I don't want to use the whole thing. I want to look at the assets that are kind of like used as collateral. So I use PP&E as a property, as a proxy here. And later on, you're going to try to exclude equipment. You're going to focus on property and plant. So for IBM, they had about $13 billion of PP&E at cost on the balance sheet in 1993. Accumulated depreciation at that point was about $6 billion. So we assume it's a 40-year and say, well, they have depreciated half of that cost. And this is, so the cost that we observe here is $13 billion after depreciation. So the purchase price, so we try to undo this and say, well, this is a 40-year asset on average. If they depreciate half of it, it's probably because they bought it 20 years ago. So they bought this asset in 1974 and used this to kind of like then calculate what's the value of market value of that real estate in 1993. So we go back to 94 and adjust by fluctuations in estate and index prices back to 1993. So in IBM's case, they will have, in 93, $58 billion of real estate assets, the way we define. Then what we try to do is we hold that asset constant and just say, how would that value vary now if real estate prices for the state in which IBM is located go up or down? So we try to isolate like any acquisitions they might do or things they might do in the future that are endogenous to the firm and just say, Given that assets, if the prices start going up 10% a year, how much would that value increase? And then try to look at whether those values affect investment, and then kind of like look at the role of reporting quality. So you can think of a regression like this. And this is not coming from our paper, by the way. We're building from this Cheney et al. Paper, so it's kind of a few financial economists that did this stuff. So they look at the investments as a dependent variable as a function of real estate value. So real estate value here means the $58 billion in 93 times the adjustment for correction in real estate fluctuation. So it could be 10% high in 94, 5% high in 95, then lower by 3% in 96, and so on. And then we fit a model that is some sort of a firm fixed effect model so that we can interpret this as some, for a given change in the real estate value, what is the change in the investment? So the result in that paper, that's not our paper yet, it's basically this sensitivity here. So if you run a regression which the dependent variable is investment in percentage points here, and you have real estate value as one of the X variables, you get a coefficient of 6. What does that mean? Is that for each dollar increase in collateral, they're able to raise 6 cents of new financing and invest about 6 cents. So there is a 6 cent per sensitivity here. If collateral goes down by a dollar, they need to cut 6 cents of financing. If it goes up by a dollar, kind of like 6 cents in finance. For my IBM example, they will have, like, say, a fluctuation of about $10 billion, like, say, in a given year or the market value. This would translate to kind of like a 600,000 change in the financing in the investment line. So what is the financial reporting quality here? Well, then we go and expand this model to have an interaction between that sensitivity and reporting quality. So what happens to that sensitivity if reporting quality was higher or lower? And reporting quality here, remember, this is a kind of first draft, where you try to use some kind of accounting-based and a market-based. So accounting-based here, like the Shandishev model of accrual quality, adjusted by the kind of measures in the Jones model. And then we try to use the adverse selection component of bid-ask spread, so those kind of two conditioning variables here. And the hypothesis that 6 cent sensitivity that we found before should become smaller as reporting quality is higher. So what we find is that if you now introduce these measures here with reporting quality, you'd have a result like this here, which is like a coefficient of 0.77. Well, what does that mean? Well, it means that if we increase standard deviation of accounting quality or spreads here, whatever the way we measure, by one standard deviation, you'd find that sensitivity to decrease about 15 and 20%. So it's like not a huge effect, but it's at least kind of 1/6 of the magnitude that they document in the finance paper. So what we'll take here is that exposure of 6 cents that you have, for example, for a firm on average, is 17% lower for a firm with a high reporting quality compared to a firm with low reporting quality. Then you go to the second hypothesis. Okay, so this is taking reporting quality exogenous. How firms could change about this? So we try to replace here investment from the left-hand side and throw disclosure, like voluntary disclosure practices on the left-hand side. So the idea is, if you have that same shock to collateral, would that affect firms' propensity to disclose? Right now in the paper, we have two measures of disclosure. One is just kind of like how much they talk on the MD&A portion of the 10K. And then we use kind of like a market-based measure, like information asymmetry component of the spread. We've done some analysis in the last couple of weeks here, like trying to kind of beef up this and then try to look at 8K counts, management forecast activity, and some other ones. It's not in the paper, but it seems to go along the same lines. But for now, let's just stick to the MD&A here and the information component. So the prediction is that if the shocks go up, let me flip that. It's easier, at least in my mind, to understand. If the shock is negative, meaning the real estate value went down, firms will disclose more. So I'd like to find this negative relation between that RE value and disclosure quality, meaning beta 1, it's negative here. So this is kind of pretty much what we find. So it's about the 1% sensitivity. So a dollar change in kind of real estate value has a 1% decrease in the length of the MD&A. So it's like like 2 cents or so. It's not like a huge debt, but it might come down to kind of like a few cents or a paragraph. But what we find is exactly consistent with this idea that as the shock becomes more positive, we find lower disclosure, And if the shock is more negative, we find higher disclosure. So firms change in disclosure, and we interpret this as a change because this is a firm fixed effective specification here. It's pretty much the overview of the paper. Let me just kind of give you one last thing, and that's the only cross-sectional cut we have for now in the paper. We've been thinking about some more, but haven't done that much yet. So we tried to look at positive versus negative shocks. And my guess here, and you can develop this argument either way, but I had a kind of like a prediction coming in that I would find results to be stronger when there is kind of bad shocks, as opposed to the good shocks, and more on the negative side. So if you go and repeat the analysis for the negative shocks, decreasing collateral versus increase, you'll find something like this. So think of the first two columns being when it's negative, and these first two columns when it's a positive shock. So the first example there is not statistically significant if you try kind of to compare here, but this second one will be. So the results are mainly on the negative side, not so much insignificant on the positive side. When you look for disclosure, it's even more apparent. Then it's like coefficient of 3 here for kind of like when there is a negative shock and kind of much more muted response when you have a positive shock. So just to take away from the paper here, Chen et al. Documented $6.06 sensitivity for a dollar change in collateral. We find that the firms with higher reporting quality have a sensitivity that it's lower by about 17% here. We also find that firms change their disclosures in response to that shock, and they seem to disclose more when you have this negative shock to kind of financing capacity. And the effect seems to be slightly larger for the decrease or negative values as opposed to the increase. Overall, how we add to the literature and what are the main findings is this idea that firms with reporting quality, if there is one thing the reporting quality is doing is mitigating the sensitivity to collateral. You know, it serves as a substitute to the ability to raise capital and continue financing. And then also kind of this idea that firms change when they are faced with this situation. And what we hope to kind of take away from this paper, some kind of new results to the literature, is that this idea that the literature is quickly developing between reporting quality and investment, but we still don't know much about the mechanism. And hopefully, if you buy the idea of the shock here, you can kind of see a little bit more about the direction of the effect. And also this idea that we can try to endogenize disclosure, so do firms change in response to this shock. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rodrigo. The research you heard until now was highly econometrics driven and empirical, statistical, and all within the existing paradigms. But I'd like you to switch your mind a little bit more now and hear some extremely interesting work that makes me think of the corridors of the kinds of firms where I spend my day. So Anette, if you could come up here.
Hello, I'm Annette Mikes from the Harvard Business School. Thanks very much for those repeated introductions. It sounds like something weird is going to come, so you are being prepared for it, just hang in there. What's happening here is that I'm a financial risk manager turned management accountant turned sociologist, so I'm bringing together three literatures in order to research something that I'm really excited about and interested in, and I'm staking my research career on, and that's the professionalization of the risk management field. So my interest is not in analysts, it's not in accountants per se, it's in the risk managers themselves who now are staking out a territory in organizational life, and you know, as you can see, or as you can hear, there are quite high stakes around. So I look at two questions in parallel. One is about how do risk managers count risk? You know, how do they come to decide to what risks to include into their remits and how to go on about measuring these or accounting for these? The second question is about what they do with these risk technologies that they are developing. Are they succeeding in influencing important organizational debates? So that's the background to this. Okay, in the context of the financial crisis, the question emerged whether risk management was succeeding or failing, and there are very divided views about this. There are obviously many issues to be discussed. There's a lot of soul searching going out there. Risk managers are also part of the soul searching movement. And there are issues that are to do with things outside their influence, like, for example, incentive structures in the companies or governance issues or regulation issues. I'm focusing here today on issues that are actually very much to do with risk managers themselves, the choices that they are making as risk professionals. I would like to link this to what Trevor started this conference with, the distinction between risk and uncertainties. It's a very important distinction, and risk managers actually face that choice on a daily basis. Every issue that they face, they have to categorize either as a risk, i.e. a statistically knowable uncertainty, or an uncertainty, which are issues that statistical models won't help them very much with. The trick is, or the difficulty is, that there is a gray area of issues that are not clearly risks proper and not clearly uncertainties. And so people have to make decisions whether, for example, the credit risk of small and medium-sized enterprises, is that a risk? Can we statistically model it? Or is that an uncertainty? It's, you know, where statistics won't help us that much. There are areas where there is not much controversy, like market risk or retail risk. But the interest here, the variation comes from the fact that there are a lot of issues in the gray area. And those are the interesting choices that they're going to be making. Right. Let me tell you a little bit about how this work is being done. It's done in the field. Good old Harvard Business School methodology. I go to companies, I talk to managers, I collect papers. I even took a 1.5-year stint in one of the banks working with the chief risk officers just to get a sense of what risk managers really do, and being one of them helped a lot. I developed this particular presentation is based on eight longitudinal, i.e. long-term case studies I undertook, and 150 interviews or more. I think I want you to hear the voices of risk managers through me. What I'm going to argue is that the growth and influence of risk managers is not just dependent on what goes on in the external environments, i.e. regulators want them to be influential or not, but it depends very much on the risk managers themselves in the organizations. And I'm going to relate this to three categories: calculative cultures, risk managers' efforts to create tools and technologies and how they make them influential or not, as the case may be. And the third one is what I call boundary work that they undertake, spend a lot of time on. Okay, let's look at why do calculative cultures matter? They matter because senior risk officers actually hold very deep and different beliefs about the usefulness of risk, risk modeling, which help them guide in making decisions in those gray areas, whether we should be intensifying our modeling of efforts or whether we should be doing something else, something to do with software instrumentation. And when I talk to risk managers, the first thing that struck me that some sound like quantitative enthusiasts. Some see modeling as the ultimate panacea of risk management problems. And what they try to do is to push as much of decision making to models, automated quantitative models, as possible. They also believe in the usefulness of these models in the sense that they capture the underlying economic reality. Now, the interesting thing comes that there's another group of risk managers who I call quantitative skeptics who do modeling because they have to and because models are informative to some extent, but have a very deeply held skepticism or circumspection about what they are learning from models. So instead of thinking that we are learning in an absolute sense about the underlying economic reality, they would say, at best, we are learning about some underlying trends. So you cannot treat models as the cornerstone, model results as the cornerstone of your decisions of yes or no. You have to do a lot of other work as well. Okay, so having conducted an attitude survey among the banks I was investigating, I sort of distilled these two calculative cultures into a couple of identifiers. So to me, the quantitative enthusiasm signifies a culture in which the senior risk officers think that risk numbers coming out of the models are representative of the underlying economic reality. And so that's why they're interested in the robust and hard nature of models. And the reason why this is important is that if these numbers are really representative of the underlying economic reality, you can use them for performance measurement. So risk-adjusted performance measurement assumes that risk numbers have a kind of absolute truth to it. The quantitative skeptics, however, think that that kind of representation is different. At best, models can inform you about trends, so it would be a mistake to try to link them to performance measurement. So these risk-adjusted performance measures are discussed, but they are not used in the same way as in the other calculative culture. Now, I associate with these calculative cultures with actually very different styles of risk management, which I observed in the case studies I'm discussing right now, and I just want to give you a high-level overview of the differences. So the first culture is associated with what I call a measurement approach to risk management. So the idea is that you're trying to quantify more and more types of risks in order to get an aggregate risk measure, like economic capital, which then you can make the basis of risk-adjusted performance measurement. So what you end up with doing, the risk managers focus on type 1 uncertainties, and the chunk of gray risk issues that they can, by more modeling and data collection, turn into known risks. The other type of approach is a bit different. There is still some modeling going on in the category of type 1 risks. However, there is a much bigger concern with the gray area risks being possibly uncertainties that you cannot go with models. So you have to use some softer instrumentation. And these practices I sort of group under the title of envisionment. What kind of practices belong here? Scenario analysis, special risk reviews when the risk manager mobilizes experience, mental models, and so on. So very different processes are privileged here as opposed to measurement and modeling. Okay, now let's try to think about so both camps of risk managers are engaged in developing technologies and tools in order to deal or carry the risk view. The question is, how do they make these tools and technologies influential? This is now the world of making risk count. And the argument I would make here is that traditionally, most risk management functions are in the category of compliance, in banking at least. And as they are building up technologies, be that economic capital modeling or scenarios or early warning indicators, whether or not these technologies are going to take them beyond the role of the box ticker depends on two things. One is whether these tools that they are building are attachable to important business processes, important to the people in the businesses that they deal with. So can they attach these to performance measurement? Can they attach these to planning? Can they attach these to quarterly business reviews, et cetera? The second aspect of this, while they are helping the businesses to make better decisions, are they succeeding in being present in that process? Are they getting disintermediated? So I observed the bank risk management function that was very successful in proliferating economic capital as an important part of the planning process. However, nobody ever asked any other questions from them anymore. They got disintermediated, disconnected. And there are other risk managers who actually are quite influential in an ad hoc way, for example, in making decisions about $1 billion mega deals. But these decisions they help making by using their own mental models. They don't turn these models into tools that others can use as well. So their influence remains localized and rather ad hoc. So for me, an influential risk management function, which can be qualified as a frame maker, does both things. Okay, and finally, there is another important aspect of the work of risk managers that I call boundary work. So this is something that they spend an awful lot of time on, which is basically explaining to others what it is that they are doing and why. What it is that turf and what it is not that turf, you know, that belongs to the accountants or whoever. The notion of boundary work comes from the history of science. And one of my surprises was, as I was reading around, was that the status of science wasn't always as high as it is now. So in Victorian England, both religion and engineering, or mechanics as it was called, had a much higher public status than science. So it took a lot of work from scientists like John Tyndall, who was the president of the Royal Society, a physicist, to convince the public that science has something superior or something important to offer, which distinguishes it, you know, and puts it above, in some sense, other competing disciplines like engineering and religion. There is quite a lot of study in the history of science about how scientists achieved this. My argument is that risk managers have to carry out the same kind of boundary work to convince others that they can set their own boundaries and there is legitimacy to it. There are three types of boundary work that historians of science talk about. One is expansion, when you are extending the boundaries of what you are doing, in this case science or risk management. One is that's called expulsion, when you are explaining to others how you are different as opposed to them. And the final is protecting your autonomy, and in particular, protecting yourself from the responsibility or the blame against the downstream consequences of your actions. What I found is that risk managers are engaged in all of these boundary work, but in slightly different ways, depending on what style of risk management they are furthering. So if you are a quantitative enthusiast, chief risk officer, you know, your expansionist work is to do with including market risk, credit risk, operational risk into the universe of quantified and aggregated risks. There is a lot of concern with showing to other functions that your calculations are accurate or more timely than theirs. And finally, very interestingly, these are the people who actually claim that their responsibility is very limited. So for the credit crisis, they are not responsible. Those decision calls were made by the board, by the chief executive, not by them. Don't blame us. The other group of risk officers engage in different boundary work. Their expansionist work involves trying to get involved with planning and with discretionary strategic decisions. When they undertake contrast or tell you about contrast, they like to contrast themselves to other risk managers, the first group, whom they consider as very theoretical and deal with risk on a compartmentalized basis. And they highlight how their informed cynicism will help the firm to make better decisions. Interestingly, these are the risk officers who leave porous boundaries between themselves and the business lines. It's really important for them to be able to go into the business, talk to the business, help them to make proposals before they come up for approval. And that kind of boundary work will not allow them to limit their responsibility. It actually extends their responsibility. So what I'm showing to you is that it's not really risk management as a singular discipline that's taking our territory. It's a variety of risk management. The work that I'm doing, I'm cataloging practices in the measurement area, cataloging practices in the envisionment area, and trying to come up with a horses for courses argument. In the future, risk managers will likely to intensify their efforts to measure more, but also to envision more. So hopefully we can see ways of bringing the best of both worlds together. And finally, I just want to emphasize that these internal processes I observed, calculative cultures, and the regulation that's around risk management can act both as enablers of that bringing the best of both worlds together, but also as potential roadblocks. Thank you very much.
I'm going to expand my own boundaries a little bit and tell you how we're going to run the Q&A. We started 15 minutes late. I think we have time for a Q&A. I'm going to leave it up to Peter and Trevor to say when that should stop.
but a very important point. I was very impressed by Trevor recognizing and hearing all these questions that were asked in sort of quiet voices from the back rows. That unfortunately doesn't work with me because too many bosses have been screaming at me for the last 15 years and I just won't hear it anymore. So Peter's kindly offered to go around with the mic. So if you could, you know, please wait for him and then ask your question. I think we have at least 15 minutes, but we potentially run over a little bit. So please ask away.
Yeah, it's a question for Mark. I'm here. Mark, so the way you motivated the hypothesis, it looked like you were talking about associations. But when it came to empirical measurement, there was a temporal precedence, something leading to something. And the question is as follows. So what you measure as accounting quality and what is observed as a smirk because of investors' behavior, is there something more primitive to it? And are those two primitives different because in your empirical test, you actually conduct horse race and you find that they are two different constructs. So what are those two primitives that lead to those observed behaviors?
What are the two primitives underlying each of, you know, the financial reporting, opacity, and the smirk curve? I can't say as much about what I think it is in the smirk curve. There's a lot of work in finance trying to figure out what those are at the index level, and arguments go from something as simple as insurance protection for a portfolio to actual banking, you know, profit-making activity. So I can't speak to that, but the primitive behind the financial reporting opacity measure is hopefully, I think what I was describing, it's this, you know, an accumulative buildup of bad news that's been hidden through financial reporting intervention. And it's sort of along the lines of, I can't remember the authors right now, out of memory, the balance sheet bloat type argument. The same type perspective is coming into play when we aggregate flows of accruals over 3 years. And so the primitive is, I think, financial intervention. Is that?
I apologize.
Yeah, that's okay. I have one comment for Anette and then one also for Rodrigo. So Anette, one thing that might be interesting, your colleague Andre Schleifer is sort of working on sort of various models, one of which provides an explanation for the crisis sort of with the idea that what happens, he tries to sort of model what happens when people don't think about certain states of nature. And he has sort of, I forgot what the term is he's used, but it's related to sort of the notion of saliency and that you don't think about these certain stains and what comes to mind is sort of what people price and what doesn't come to mind doesn't. The interesting implication from that, sort of related to your work, is that that you need to basically, to some extent, develop tools that make people think about certain states of nature that otherwise would be ignored. So the comment I have for Rodrigo is, Rodrigo, you were sort of saying that you're using sort of a state shock to get away from the endogeneity of the firm-specific shocks. I'm not sure that that works in your particular example or design, because the way you instrumentalize the shock is you take the state shock. That's fine. But then you're saying, you know, firms are differentially hit depending on whether they have property or not in the state and whether they're located in the state. So the shock is indeed a firm-specific shock, because if you have shock to Connecticut and you not don't have assets in Connecticut, you're not sort of affected by the shock. You are affected by the shock because you have assets in Connecticut. And so in the end, you, just to sort of relate that to the, if you take the Enron shock that we looked at, right, there what you have, what you're worried about is firms that are suppliers or somehow related to Enron. These are precisely the firms that you wouldn't want to have, because for those you're going to be worried that it's really bad news about the firm, and that the bad news about the firm drives their investment behavior and drives their disclosure. But, and then the two are related, but it's not because in any way that, that there's no causal relationship, and financial reporting has no incremental role in that. See right. what I'm saying?
No, I see. But I think what we're trying to do is a little bit of the both things you said, because I don't want the shock to be firm specific, but I would like the shock to affect firms differentially. So what we do is that we pick a state level variation to, so that the shock is exogenous multiplied by the firm specific assets. So there are firms that have a, yeah, then it's a firm-specific implication, but coming from a kind of like exogenous source. That's the idea. Like, because I could use kind of just kind of the change in the value of those firms, but that could much more easily reflect change in growth opportunities for that firm as opposed to kind of like some sort of state one. So that's the identification where it's coming from. But absolutely, it's not just a variable that changes at the industry level. It's totally firm-specific because it's the interaction of the two.
Charles?
Just a constructive suggestion or question about Rodrigo's paper, and I'm very sympathetic to this. Actually, Glenn Hubbard and I wrote an article in 1990 in the Economic Journal on exactly the role of collateral in mitigating financing constraints. So I agree with you; it's a great idea. But I also thought that the asymmetry effect that you found was quite interesting for a reason that you didn't mention, though, which is, you need something additional than just the collateral being an exogenous shock. You also need it to be uncorrelated with the marginal product of capital of the investment, of the incremental investment project. Otherwise, you don't know whether it's a collateral effect or a change in effectively Tobin's Q. Now, of course, you have an average Tobin's Q, it looked like, in your model, but that can be measured with error, and so the marginal Tobin's Q can be different from that. Now, the fact that you're finding it asymmetric is quite interesting, because if it were just a measure, if it were just correlated with the investment marginal product of capital, it should be symmetric. So it's kind of interesting that you're finding a larger effect on the downside, which would be consistent with it being a financial constraint effect. So I'm sympathetic, right? But I have another sort of puzzle in this, which is, if a firm is financially, suppose we have two firms that are financially constrained, one firm that's financially constrained, one that's not. The firm that's financially constrained is going to try to avoid holding assets that aren't part of its core competency, in particular real estate. We've been talking about that in finance for about 30 years, right? Lease rather than own real estate if it's not part of your core competency, especially if you're subject to finance constraints. So the fact that you're finding, your story is, financially constrained firms are holding lots of real estate that's not part of their core competency. That's what's necessary for it not to be correlated with the marginal product of capital. But then that's kind of puzzling. Why are they doing that? So I guess my point is, you got an endogenous variable here, which is holding the collateral in the first place, which should be negatively correlated with your degree of financial constrainedness. So it's just all a little bit confusing. I'm actually finding your results quite interesting, but I think it's interesting to explore some of these things.
Yeah, no, thank you. The financing constraint actually is giving us a little bit of a problem, because you have these issues, like to be able to sort in the financing constraint, but sort on that, you're almost sorting on the identification, right? The financing constraint firms will select and have a different kind of real estate assets than the other ones. And in all fairness, the guys that did this in the finance paper, they still show a financing constraint effect subject to the endogeneity caveat that you're saying. So I know from my results here that when the more constrained firms suffer more. What we are finding little, and this is something we've been doing the last week here, last week or two, is that we don't find so much on the accounting quality in the constraint, because when you sort the constraint, we sort often on the variation in accounting quality as well, because constraint affects the reporting quality. So it's almost that
We would like to sort on something that is orthogonal to our test variable, but we are not being able to do that, and we still don't know how to resolve. So I take the comment, but I don't actually have a good answer at this point. And thanks for the comment on the growth opportunities, though. This is the other thing that we presented this paper twice now, and then I always feel that we need to do something about the productivity and the growth opportunities to make sure we're just not capturing that. And the original paper, they have some sort of IV approach and a few things that they did to mitigate their concern, but it's not something that we have had time to fold in our analysis yet, so there's more to come. But thanks for the suggestion.
Question over there.
I have two questions or comments. One for Rodrigo, one for Mark. My comment for Rodrigo is probably related to Christian's point. It seems to me that you may need to find a way to control for stock performance, because you're looking at the change in real estate price. But I assume when real estate prices is falling in a given state, the stock price of the firms located in that state will tend also to fall. There will be a very strong positive correlation between the two. And when your stock price is falling, then there will be more requirement for you to provide disclosure, and that's going to affect your behavior in so many different ways. So controlling for the stock price is very, very important in your setting. And regarding Mark's paper, my concern is your opacity measure could simply be a measure of earnings volatility. Using the absolute value of a discretionary accruals, and that could simply capture earnings volatility, and that will have the obvious implications.
That's exactly right. Right. So then you end up, the non-nice way to say it is, then you end up regressing volatility on volatility and finding a positive. But what we're doing right now, and I sort of glossed over all the other variables in the model, is opacity indeed, by picking up a summation of accruals, you could very well be capturing that. And so even though we control for earnings volatility separately, it's still a concern. But we're redoing this to sort of scrap the whole idea of opacity as the single feature to look at for, you know, stockpiling bad news, but expand it to more things along the lines of Binesh has a fraud prediction model, which is sort of the same idea, right? And it incorporates a number of different variables, like, you know, number of years of sales increases. This is sort of what Galbraith said when he starts seeing good news in terms of reported performance. I'll paraphrase it, but he shorts the crap out of that stock. And it's sort of the same idea here, that we're gonna look at a number of different measures. And we've already found that there are more explanatory variables for both price drops and the smirk than just opacity, which has the exact negative feature that you mentioned. Okay.
Thank
you. Yeah, this is for Anette. I think you divided the world of risk managers into the quantitative enthusiasts and quantitative skeptics, if I remember correctly. And I'm wondering whether in your observations and all the work, you found any correlation between those categorizations and the positioning and impact of the risk management people on the organization. And I'm just kind of thinking from my own experiences, you know, in the early 90s, when the bond trading scandal hit Solomon Brothers, we found out that they had positioned the controllers, and, you know, at that time were kind of like the risk managers, to report to the business unit heads. People said that's not a real good idea. So a lot of the big investment banks then separated the controllership function from the business units in terms of reporting lines and responsibility and authority and all of that. Then we hear from the latest financial crisis that some of the banks, investment banks, that loaded up on, you know, mortgage-backed securities and heavily involved in real estate one way or the other, had gone back to the model of having people report to the business unit heads, and, you know, so ostensibly they didn't have much impact. on there. And I'm just kind of wondering from your observations whether you came across that kind of thing, or we see that anecdotally that you know, Goldman Sachs, which I believe has a big culture of risk management and authority of that group in there, they decided they may have let the traders keep dancing while the music was playing, but at the firm a year or so in advance of the problems in the, you know, widespread problems becoming revealed in mortgage-backed securities, they started taking some macro hedges at the firm-wide level.
Okay, thanks, Bob, for the question. It's actually one of those questions that I'm also very interested in. I can understand it in two ways. One is that you're looking for the different types of influences that different types of risk managers are vying for, trying to get. And there's a structure, a second interpretation, which is a structure question. Where do you place the risk manager in the organizational structure? So dealing with the first bit, very briefly, depending on whether you are a quant enthusiast or seeing the world in a quant enthusiast way or a quant skeptic way, you're going to try to carve out different types of influence because you feel your relevance comes in different areas of decision making. So the competitive advantage of quant enthusiasts is this ability to quantify and aggregate risks, which becomes really handy when it comes to economic capital and linking economic capital to planning and performance measurement. That's a very different influence from those who say, actually, we don't have a competitive advantage there because these economic capital calculations, we don't believe really reflect the economic reality. So we are best to kind of advise on a discretionary basis in the business lines or the chief executive or the group executive committee about things that can, you know, bad things that can happen to even good organizations. So then these kind of skeptics are looking more for a discretionary, strategic, advisory type influence. Now, whether or not they can achieve these types of influence, it goes together with their positioning in the organization. So in the first case, it's actually quite useful for the risk function to be independent from the business line. And there is a debate whether you are more efficient in economic capital if you are reporting to the CFO because you can collaborate with the finance people or you can do it independently. Anyway, you have to be independent from the business line to make them accept these calculations. In the second case, however, you absolutely have to cross the boundaries into the business because you need to earn your spurs in order to be an advisor. So that's why I'm arguing that this other type of capital cultures comes with other type of risk professionals. And I think the Goldman Sachs folks have, you know, seen the benefits of crossing the business lines and have carved out influence in areas that are not just measurement related but envisionment as well.
Mark, do you have a question?
I just had a couple thoughts to Mark. The first one was,
do you want to?
Sorry, is it on? Take this one.
Is that working?
Okay, so.
It's good enough.
Thank you. Okay, so, I mean, the first one is, it seems like your measure of opacity, right? If you were to use something that was more smoothing oriented, like going back to what Steve said earlier about the fact that he's sort of suspicious of firms that show really smooth earnings, because even though it's measured with noise, the noise kind of works against you as opposed to working for you, right? So that seems like that might be something worth considering. The other thing that was striking to me about the fact that you were only going with sort of the drop side of things, right, is that it seems like you're saying that opacity is sort of predicting future stock returns because you're only thinking about one direction, right? So I was wondering if you, I mean, would you say that that's true, that basically you'd be arguing that opaque stocks are going to underperform on average? And it goes back to Anoop's point, right? Because Anoop was saying, I don't really know what the smirk is capturing for sure. And so to ask the question, is it sort of capturing this information efficiently, presumes the underlying construct is the smirk is trying to capture that information. But it seems like the future returns would be maybe a different way to think about it.
So your first comment is well taken, but the second, you know, why we don't look at, I'm not really sure how to noodle with it, but why not look at, are you saying look at measured returns rather than an actual stock price drop?
Well, what I'm saying is, wouldn't one of your implications be that you could earn excess returns based on this? Because all you're doing is looking, does this predict a stock price drop, right? You're only one side of this.
Yeah, the perspective we have doesn't really show up, and it's actually right along the lines of the standard Altman model of trying to predict a rare event like bankruptcy, or I mentioned Banesh's model of trying to predict a rare event like fraud. Here we're trying to use accounting to predict a rare event like a big stock price drop. Whether it's, you know, saying that these are going to be underperforming in a stock return sense in the long term, I don't think I'd want to commit to that. It's just that their returns, say the negative returns that normally would accompany the disclosure of bad news, get compressed into a stock price drop, which for us is a 1 week period. Now backing up to the idea of what's, you know, the primitive behind the actual smirk, you know, we're not so bold as to think that, you know, option traders are out there waiting for the 10K to be released and scouring it for opacity and this type of thing. So in the end, it seems like it's more of a supplemental piece of information for the stock price drop rather than trying to explain necessarily the smirk as a function of financial reporting. I'm doubtful that that's what's going on.
You've all been fantastic in keeping to the schedule. I think we have time for one more question over here. Go ahead.
It's a question for Doron, I guess largely because no one's asked you any question, but no, seriously. I had a question regarding those graphs you showed on the implied cost of capital. I thought they were very interesting, but I had like a couple of comments. One of them is, the models you used have a big book value component. You're using a residual income valuation model. So it's not surprising that when analysts sort of adjust their forecast, price takes a big impact. But the sort of the valuation equation doesn't really change very much because of the book value. So it's not surprising that the discount rate is going to take this big spike, right? And if you look at the graphs you showed, it sort of came back pretty, soon after the sort of market recovered. So don't you think you're sort of reading too much into your results, especially around that crisis time when you sort of refer to the implied cost of capital as a sort of true measure of risk? Because it could just be the fact that, the price crashes, and the sort of valuation, yes, the analysts do adjust their forecast downwards, but the book value component sort of keeps the valuation model sort of, the RHS sort of big, and so the discount rate has to pick up all the slack, right?
So you basically have the price, book value, and the present value of residual earnings.
Right.
So think about moving book value to the other side. So now we have price minus book value, and you basically have the present value of residual income. So basically what I'm doing is it's the premium that is being explained being equal to the present value of residual earnings. So I'm not sure I'm seeing your point. It's still price minus book. It's the premium. It's always the premium that is equal to the present value of residual income. So if you have a drop in the premium, you should see a drop in the present value of the residual income.
No, I think generally RIV-based models, sort of the book value sort of dominates the valuation to a large extent. So it would be interesting to sort of look at alternative models of implied cost of capital as well to see if you find similar sort of patterns in that as well. So.
Okay. Terrific. Thank you very much. Thanks, everyone, for your attention. And thanks to the panel for great presentations.